One. Okay, this should now be recording. This is the Digressionists. By the way, I'm not sure what episode we're on. I think it's in the low 20s still. But I guess I'm going to have to go and look at the last things and find out exactly.
We have a record here tonight. With inside of a month, not within a calendar month, but within a month, we have done 2 Digressionist episodes.
I know, it's pretty good. So I'll have Marty Rice over here. I'll have him do his, I guess it's that way in the cam, but I'll have him do his little introduction. I'm Chris Wilson out here in Columbus, Ohio. And with me tonight, as always on the Digressionist, is Marty Rice here at in Johnstown, PA.
Good old Johnstown.
Good old Johnstown. And so, you know, I think what we kind of had a lot of conversation back and forth with this new Michael Moore movie, and we've certainly been looking at various responses and critics and people who accuse them of using very old information.
And Moore's response to his critics as well.
And Moore's response to his critics. And I think that's the thing that we looked at, although maybe we should post the link to that.
Link
but
down below. We'll put the link down below.
We'll put the link down below. And it's not very long for Michael Moore's response. It's maybe 15 minutes, but there was stuff in there that just made me insane. Because when we left last time, we kind of realized that when you watch this movie, you think, well, what do they really want? And so 2 things are very clear from it all. As always, they want an end to capitalism. By the way, if you do any work in environmental ethics, there is this phrase known as people who are watermelons. That is, you are green on the outside and deep red on the inside. Red as in sort of commie red. So
that's a takeoff from the racist comment on Asian people about them being bananas.
Bananas. Well, but it just means that
terrible.
A lot of environmentalists fit that bill. You know, the green is just this facade on the outside, because what they really want more than anything is this end to capitalism. And so Michael Moore goes on, and so he lays his cards on that. And hopefully we'll talk about that, because the thing that gets me is you don't have a clue how capitalism works. I mean, he doesn't have a clue. He starts talking about Wall Street and the demands that Wall Street makes. And by the way, not every company is on the stock exchange, Michael Moore. And it doesn't work like that anyway. So we'll talk about that tonight. And of course, the other thing that becomes very clear, but they won't tell you what it really entails, is what they really want for us is to have a very much lower standard of living. But it's not clear what that means. So by the way, they celebrate the COVID years as just, it's great because it's slowing down consumption and it's just great. This is the way we should live all the time. Or they keep talking about how great the recession was of 2008. And I'd imagine if there was a full-on depression, they'd think that was absolutely wonderful too. Obviously Michael Moore would, because he's probably got enough stuff stored in his basement that he would get.
Or his bank account.
In his bank account. Yeah. But
they also talk about how we reduced CO2 emissions during that time period as well.
Well, yeah, reduced. By the way, and then there's one giant fallacy. Well, I'll lead with this and I'll have you talk. There is this movement called 350, which is that in the environmental ethics movement is that if you get to more than 350, what is it, million, parts per million,
CO2.
Of CO2, and Michael Moore says this in his reply, then it's game over. Game over. There's nothing we can do. It's runaway. It's going to happen. It's just an environmental catastrophe. There's nothing that can be done. Then he says in the same breath, I mean, can you believe this? Well, we're at 410 now. What the hell are we doing? We better get busy. Well, you just said it's game over at 350. So why don't you just
They don't listen to their own BS.
I didn't listen to what he just said 2 minutes ago. I mean, listen, I hope somebody watches this. I don't know if this would ever reach Michael Moore, but what an absolute knucklehead to say that. You might as well go out and grill a nice steak and have a big bonfire and do whatever the hell you want to do, because by your own logic, by what you've just said, it doesn't matter. There's no
point. It doesn't matter. So we may as well enjoy life. Let's go out and enjoy.
So then he's turning around telling us, oh, we've got to really buckle down. Well, it's 350 is the end of the world, or it's 410 or it's 4. But you know what? For God's sake, stick to it once you get it.
Whatever it is, yeah, be consistent.
Yeah.
Be consistent. Remember, there's that line from Ralph Waldo Emerson about, and by the way, I was in love with Emerson when I was in undergraduate school, reading all of his stuff, the Divinity School address and other things, where he says that consistency is the hobgoblin of little minds.
Little minds. And probably Michael Moore must endorse that because he obviously is not very concerned about consistency.
I might be wrong about Emerson saying that, but I think it was Emerson who said
it's,
that.
I mean,
Emerson scholars out there, feel free to attack me and correct me on that. Yeah, go ahead, Chris.
No, and the whole thing, I just sat there and listened to Michael Moore's rebuttal and thought, this guy's a complete knucklehead, just a complete knucklehead. I mean, he contradicts himself within two sentences, and then he starts, you know, yapping on about how we've got to get rid of capitalism, because the argument basically is that the capitalist system is just this rapacious thing that just destroys the natural resources such that at some point there'll be some horrible catastrophe. What we need to do is chuck the whole capitalist system, have this massively lower standard of living. Population, well, we don't really want to talk about whether or not we should get this lower population, but I think they're really deeply in favor of it.
He's viewing capitalism as something that has to always have more and more increased growth. Now, if I can interject something here about that always gets me angry, is that from the political spectrum, because it makes good political news, good political hay, you always find congressional leaders, the president, talking about the growth of the gross national product. We always have to keep that growing. So it sounds like we always have to keep using more and more resources, okay, getting more and more consumption all the time. I think a lot of that is motivated by political press. It's good press to say that, because people are thinking, well, gee, wealth is being spread around and I can get a job and blah, 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 blah. But I think the motivation there does not come from capitalism per se as a necessary requirement on capitalism. It comes from people running for political office. You hear it all the time. Now, what's the unemployment figures? What's the gross national product, the GNP? If it's getting higher, oh, politically good. If it's getting lower, oh, politically bad. Okay. And so politicians are tarring each other with those kinds of feathers. And if you take any of that seriously, then you're going to think that, yeah, well, maybe Moore's got a point. But I want to say it's motivated by politics and not actually by capitalism itself, for the most part.
Yeah, and I think that's true. And I think if you look at, for example, if you look at the lifestyle of most Americans, it's not some kind of crazy thing where next year I have to buy another house and I have to have a fourth car and a fifth. I mean, it doesn't really work that way. I mean, people reach a certain kind of steady state. We're all at different levels, but it really isn't that, you know, I just have to go get more and more and more stuff. It just, that doesn't follow. And right now, I think it's probably true that Americans are very much not interested in having as much stuff in a lot of ways as they used to in the past. There are many, many things. For example, it's a complaint about millennials that they don't want their parents' old China, and they don't want their parents. They have very minimal interest in a lot of the sort of trappings of life.
Yes. So let me digress on that, okay, if I may. You hear this from a lot of millennial newlyweds. This is our starter house. Oh, it's just our starter house. Okay. So you're going to start and then you got to go somewhere and get a bigger and better house. Okay. It's our starter house. And then you do have these people. Again, I think it's a millennial thing where, yeah, they purchased a new car 2-3 years down the road. They got to trade it in and get yet another new car. Okay. Whereas, you know, somebody in my generation, as my Saab 9.5 is 17 years old, and I finally broke down and bought a newer car. I bought a 2016 Mazda CX-5. I got both cars. I'm going to keep both cars And the Mazda, I'm going to keep until, you know, it literally falls apart. And that's what I've done with cars in,
well,
in the past.
But one thing I will, the point about housing, but that's probably been true for decades, that people who have gotten married, you know, even in the 40s, 50s, did, as they had kids, probably expanded the size of their home. But a lot of millennials today are not buying cars at all. They want to live in cities. They don't have automobiles. They live in very small apartments. They don't want a lot of the trappings. Look at the tiny house movement. Now, some of this, maybe it's they've been fed a line about how consumption is evil, so maybe they're just not doing it or not doing it yet. I think a lot of it is an excuse that they don't have money, so they begin to say, well, you know, I don't want to have the trappings of all this stuff, you know.
And it's trendy too.
Yeah, it is
trendy. The tiny house movement, the people living in a van they've turned into a little mobile home. You have these nomad people running all over the place, living, say, from one Walmart parking lot to another in different states, which I think is great. You know, I like having a stable home, but I think the things they do with their little vans where they live nomadically is actually very cool.
It's great, certainly, if you're, you know, 19, 20, 21, something like that. But, you know, I don't know, as you get older. But, you know, the whole idea that we're just ever consuming more and more things, that we just, our appetites are never ending. I just don't think that measures up. You know, people reach a certain state, but as they get older, oftentimes they find themselves saying, you know, I've got what I need. I don't need a whole lot. I need, you know, the basics to continue on and to replace some things, but I don't have to have a flying car. And they never gave us that anyway. We were all supposed to have that by now, for sure. And we've never gotten that damn flying car.
Well, I remember watching a Walt Disney show as a kid. Walt Disney used to be on Sunday nights for an hour, came on about 8 o'clock, 8 to 9. And they would have sometimes a science section where they talked about nuclear energy. And one section where I heard them talk about, well, what's the next step in nuclear energy? Nuclear powered cars. And I thought that was going to be great. A nuclear powered car. Okay. So, you know, replacing the steam car or something like that.
We never got that. And no, the other thing, I don't know if you shared that with me, but it's interesting that the electric car goes back over 100 years ago. There was a battle fought over whether, and we certainly had electric cars, and there were concerns, and there were all the issues about charging stations. So a lot of this stuff is not new. It's just being brought out again. And so I know you wanted to talk a little bit about maybe Tesla and some of the things that are going on with that.
Can I talk about that now?
It's up to you, either that or launch into the biomass. The other
what I want to do is talk about some of the comments that our friend Patrice from Montreal, whom, by the way, we should have back on the show here pretty soon, left us on our last video about biomass and the efficiency of electric cars. And in the past couple of weeks or so, if I can share a screen here, this has come to light about electric cars, about the Tesla in particular. Let me see if I can find it here. And here we go. And this is from Haverford, Pennsylvania. Is this Bert? No, this is, let's see if this is the one I want.
This is Tesla caught fire.
The news story comes from Berkeley, California, but it's about a guy in Haverford, Pennsylvania, who's driving down the road. And by the way, Haverford, that's out on the main line of Philadelphia. And that's where you got a huge concentration of money, and lots of higher end CEOs and executives live out there. And let's see, his Tesla, while he's driving it, catches fire, and the electronic door system jams. Okay, so he has to use force to push it open. But now let me just tell you something, digress on this again, digression within digression, is that this is a problem with just about every new car today. You can't roll up the windows without turning the whole car on. If your electrical system fails, okay, you're not going to get through a window of your car. So just imagine if you're doing a Teddy and Mary Joe off the bridge, you know, and your electrical system has failed. Are you going to be able to get out of the car by rolling down a window? I don't even know if you could do that in a car with crank handles, but anyway, this makes it all much more difficult. So his car continued to move for about 35 feet before turning into a fireball. And what's interesting about this is the fire departments that responded to this had received extensive training on dealing with battery fires in cars. So this must not be just an isolated incident. In fact, I know it's not. Okay. In San Francisco, a Tesla being charged in a garage overnight caught fire, burned down the garage and part of the home. This has also happened with the Chevy Bolt. Patrice has reminded us how efficient the electric cars are at turning battery energy into mechanical work. I guess you can say they're also efficient at producing fires as well. So,
or they give you the advice, right, not to charge it in your garage. Well, then where do you charge your electric car if you can't?
I will need a 200 foot long cable to make sure it's charging in the street and burns down the other cars that it's parked next to,
I guess. Yeah, and that may not work either, to have these long extension cords charging. You know, that there's issues with that. So I'm not sure.
Well, the longer the cord, the more electrical resistance you get in the cord.
Yeah.
Do they start to heat up? If they're lying in the grass, will your grass catch fire? Mm-hmm. Will children be burned if they come along and play with them? That'll probably be the next issue. Mm-hmm. Children playing with the cables going to the electric cars being charged in the street. And how it's a danger to children. So Tesla had no immediate comment on this. Okay. And this, by the way, is the high-end Model S sedan, a $130,000 car. Okay.
Yeah, $130,000 and it goes up in a giant fireball. That's got to make your day.
Yeah. A really expensive way to start a fire.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And you're liberating all of that energy,
yes,
all in
as CO2.
Yeah, well, I'm assuming that the fire, yeah, who knows what gets spewed out in it, but I'm sure it's quite toxic to do that.
Well, okay. Do I still have the floor here?
Yeah, sure.
I can launch into biomass.
Sure.
And let me put up here on our share screen something that our friend, and by the way, we should mention Patrice is a very good friend, and I certainly appreciate the fact that he reads or listens to our videos and that he takes the time to respond and attack us. Okay. Except I think he said something in his last comments very positive about your comments on authenticity. Okay. But here we go. With respect to biomass being green, it's usually the sleight of hand of having the burning emit the CO2 that a crop captured when growing. So on balance, it's neutral to the CO2 in the atmosphere. Now that's assuming that the only thing that went in to the part of the tree that burns is atmospheric CO2. Mm. And I can't believe that.
That can't be true. No.
Okay. As opposed to burning fossil fuels where it's new CO2, that was underground. Now, let me say this. If you can make this argument about trees, that it's carbon neutral with burning the tree, you're only giving back to the atmosphere what the tree took in to begin with, then hell, it's the same story with the damn coal.
It sure is, because you're only releasing the CO2 that went
into the coal. CO2 that was captured 100 million years ago, and that's all we're putting back today.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's the same damn story, you know, and I'm sorry. That's the case. It is the same story with the coal. The coal is putting back into the atmosphere what the ancient ferns and trees 100 million years ago.
Besides, here's the other fallacy of that. The trees existing today are doing things which are positive for the environment. The coal, however, is not doing a damn thing if it's underground one way or the other. So why would you remove the trees?
Exactly.
I mean, I understand that they're providing a positive function to this day, you know, emitting oxygen. Why would you take that source away?
Well, let's just get back to the atmosphere, the 100 million year old CO2 that was in it to begin with. Mm-hmm. Okay. And Patrice, sure, fine. Respond to me on this. Okay. That's great. But I think there is a massive fallacy here where you think that all you're doing is returning to the atmosphere everything that was there to begin with. I don't buy it. Okay. There's more to the tree than just atmospheric CO2. Otherwise, why does the damn tree have roots?
And is he admitting that in fact, the biomass industry basically is burning trees? It's not burning pine cones and floor scrapings and some other weird, they usually make it sound like it's some kind of yard trimmings or something. It's not, it's trees.
Well, talking about biomass hides the truth. It's a way to talk about, it's a way to hide the truth is what it is.
Yeah.
It's just biomass.
Yeah, it's now, just biomass.
People don't have any definite idea about what the biomass is. Is it corn stalks?
Right. Okay. Is it corn stalks? Is it, yeah, yard trimmings? It's like that thing about gluten, that like the magician's thing where the gluten comes out of the, we take the gluten out of it. The Michael Carbonaro takes the gluten out of, I don't know what it was, but it was like a piece of bread.
That and this,
yeah, gelatinous stuff that would fill this cup, you know, five times over comes out. And people stand there and say, oh, gosh, thank God you can get that gluten out of there. That's so good, you know, because that gluten is bad. I mean, it's just, yeah, biomass is one of these words. Nobody knows what the hell you're talking about.
Exactly. So, you know, when you open your eyes, and by the way, even though on some of these films, we have seen people say, Bill McKibben was never in favor of biomass. Hell, in the Michael Moore film, you have him praising a biomass electric generator at a university and applauding it. Come on. You can't,
I mean,
tell me.
It's right in there. I mean, if anything, Bill McKibben sounds like he just doesn't know what the hell he's talking about and contradicts himself on a regular basis. That's what
Bill McKitter.
Yeah.
Bill McKitter. That's what he should be.
He
now,
should
one
be.
Other thing. Let me share with you one other thing here. Another comment from, again, our good friend Patrice. And I think this is it. Yeah. Okay. With respect to, this is about the electric car being more efficient. Okay. And first of all, I'm not going to doubt that. Okay. I think the electric car is more efficient in taking electrical energy and transforming it to mechanical energy. I don't know what the efficiency rating is. Okay. Let's read this. With respect to electric cars versus the internal combustion engine, the numbers show that because the electric car is far more efficient at transforming potential energy into kinetic energy, and I'll give you that, and recuperating some of it when braking, okay, that even a 100% coal-fired electric source EV car produces less CO2 than an internal combustion engine car.
But
now,
again,
yeah. If you're talking about just battery to mechanical energy, yes. But what happens? How do you get the energy into the goddamn battery? Forgive my language, to begin with.
And the production of the battery, the production that, you know, when you do the full life cycle costing of what it takes to manufacture that car, you got to put that into account.
And this was Ozzy Zehner's point in the movie, that nobody takes that into account.
No.
That, you know, you have to trace it all the way back.
The article that I have, which I should share with you, says that when your electric car is delivered, it is the equivalent of an internal combustion engine with 50,000 miles already driven on it. So in other words,
that's interesting.
There's an enormous amount of energy in delivering you the electric and producing the battery. So I don't know. Yeah, if you're just talking about you put one car on the road and the other car on the road, but this is the fallacy that people have in electric car, and they say, well, it doesn't consume any. It doesn't pollute at all.
Mm-hmm.
Going down the road, I'm not putting out any. I mean, you're certainly putting out thermal pollution, I'm assuming, but
yeah.
I mean, it's not a perpetual motion machine.
Not a perpetual motion machine, no.
I mean, it takes energy, and whether or not it's really true, I would imagine that the energy to propel a car of a certain weight, you know, I would be surprised that they're not somewhat fairly similar, because it takes just a certain amount of oomph to get this body to go down the road. And I can't imagine that it would be so amazingly efficient compared to internal.
Well, I wonder what the, now Patrice in this comment doesn't say what the efficiency rating is, and I don't know what the efficiency rating is on the car. You also have to take into account battery memory effect. As you keep charging the car, it doesn't charge to the same level as it does before when you first
And what do you do with the batteries once they're completely spent? And no one has addressed that.
No, no one has addressed what to do with these things. They are certainly, as far as I know, they are not recyclable.
Well, and the one thing about internal combustion cars is we recycle virtually all of the steel. The engines, which are generally made of steel or aluminum, are recycled. Most everything is taken out and reused in some sense or other, but it's fundamentally...
It's basically the only way I can get new parts for my Saab 9.5.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's true. That's true. But I mean, you know, we do a pretty good job of, you know, the end of life for internal combustion cars. I mean...
Oh, yeah. I think we do. I might be a little wrong about that. I also wonder, too, how with regenerative braking in things not only like EVs, but, you know, the car I really love to hate, the Toyota Prius.
Oh, the Prius.
The thing that looks like a cheese wedge and can go 0 to 25 miles an hour in a week and a half.
Have you ever driven one, by the way?
Yeah, I have, unfortunately.
But, you know, they do that thing where they sort of stop when you come to a, when you come to a stop sign or something, like the engine stops. And it's very disconcerting if you're used to driving a car that you're...
Well, it's very disconcerting when you push down on the gas pedal and it takes you 10 seconds to start moving or something of that nature. But I wonder, too, the toll of regenerative braking on your brake pads and rotors.
Yeah, that I don't know either.
You know, I don't know either. You know, if that's going to put more, more wear on your brake pads and rotors than a car that does not have regenerative braking, I don't know. But yeah, the Toyota Prius, miserable car, miserable design. You sit in it, and you can't see over the dashboard. All the dials, there are no dials on the dashboard. It's just all a green LED or LCD screen.
Doesn't have like a little tree that grows or something that when you're...
Oh, yeah. Damn tree. I can't figure that out.
I know.
And when the sun, you know, on a sunny day, you cannot see your dashboard.
Yeah.
You cannot tell how fast you're going, what your energy consumption is, what the battery profile looks like.
Yeah.
It's a miserable car to look at. It's a miserable car to drive. Okay. I have a friend who drives one. She knows who she is. She's probably watching this video and not admitting to it.
It's like my neighbor. They have a friend, and he was going through a midlife crisis, and you know, because he was 45 years old or something. And I thought, well, he probably bought a Corvette. And then he tells me, so he goes out and buys a Prius because he's having a mid. What kind of man buys a Prius when he's having a midlife crisis?
I mean, you ain't a man.
You're not a man.
You ain't a man.
Yeah, you get a Corvette or something. You don't get a Prius. I mean, this is like, oh, could you have your, put your masculinity in a blind trust at that point, I think.
No, what you do is you buy a reconditioned Saab 900 Turbo is
what
you do.
That would be fine
too. Convertible, red convertible with a tan interior. That's what you do. That's my dream car. Okay, I'm way past having a midlife crisis.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm probably about to have an end-of-life crisis.
End-of-life crisis, yeah, exactly. And then eventually it becomes, it just simply isn't a crisis, but it's the end of life, whatever.
Yeah, it's whatever.
It's there, yeah.
Okay, well, that's my rant about biomass. And Patrice, please feel, in fact, Patrice, I beg you to respond. You're the only person who puts comments on our videos.
I think too, with the biomass, I mean, I think, you know, the point is you've got to get, we need to know specifically what they're burning at some biomass plant. And by the way, in the movie, the plant that was, they were showing up in Michigan that was trying to burn like lawn clippings because they can't get the fire hot enough. They were adding shredded tires to the mixture to get to get the flames and that to get it hot enough. And then when they were looking at the pollution that was settling, when they analyzed that on the windowsills, lots of toxic material coming out of it. Well,
especially from a tire. Didn't you at one time in Columbus have this trash burning power plant under your mayor Dana Reinhart years and years ago?
I don't know if those are still around, but yeah, and then they kept exploding. They kept exploding because of the paint cans that would be in there, and they would.
And all the other bad stuff.
Yeah, but I mean, so you know, it's. I mean, I just think biomass is. Yeah, it's another one of these things. It sounds good, but you don't really want to know. I just don't really want to know the details of it. But the other thing that makes me confused about this movie is you've got all of these activists, and they want wind and solar and biomass, and they hate, I mean, they just hate with a passion, Mobil, Exxon, all of that's just big business, and they just loathe that. But they want to replace the current system with all of these things, but then they're shocked to find out that wind and solar then becomes a big business. Well, yeah, if you're going to have it replace stuff, it sure as hell is going to be a big business. And who do you think's going to run it? They're not doing it in a nonprofit arrangement. These are companies that are making money. And yeah, it is a little hypocritical for Al Gore to be behind a lot of that. I get it. And that should be a criticism. But I mean, what do you think? People are just going to make these things? It's not a cottage industry. We don't make solar panels in our garage. We don't.
That's true. True.
It takes big business, and it takes energy, and it turns out, an awful lot of oil, gas, that kind of traditional energy, coal-fired stuff to produce it.
And certainly, if you're Exxon, and you're looking for business, and you're looking to expand, dollar signs are going to go up in your eyes when you look at the green energy.
You're going to look at it and say, let's get involved in that. Why wouldn't you?
We'll get government subsidies. Joe Biden says he wants to cut off all government subsidies to gas and oil. Okay, so if I'm one of those executives, I'm going to say, fine, but you're going to give me subsidies in my biomass efforts. So yeah. I'm going to go into the solar panel production. I'm going to go into the wind farm production. You're going to give me all those wonderful subsidies because these things don't make money. So I'm going to take your wonderful subsidies, and the dollar signs will just light up in my eyes for doing that. Yeah. And I've already got the infrastructure, the business infrastructure, the economic infrastructure on the ground, ready to go. And I am ready to jump in on this.
Yeah. Okay. And I still probably have all my connections, and I've got my leases for oil and gas. So when it turns out that none of this stuff works to the degree that it should, we're right back into, you know, what we do already.
We're right back into it. Exactly.
So I just don't know, you know, if you hate capitalism, how do you make all of these, how do you put all of these industries together? I guess you assume that somehow the government will be in the business with me. So we'll have the People's Solar Panel Company. I mean, where the hell is that ever?
And the quality, you know, you want to talk about how the movie misrepresented the advances in solar panel technology, because it's showing this movie from the mid-90s at this solar festival, then you're really going to have a quality problem when you've got the government manufacturing solar panels.
Yeah, in a non-competitive environment. And if anything, we have made progress because there has been capitalist competition, even though they may be competing for these subsidies and so forth, but you still have different labs and different places where people are investing and putting this stuff together. It's still a very competitive industry.
Still American ingenuity at work. My apologies to Canada. You do have Canadian ingenuity up there. Back years ago, you manufactured one of the best fighter planes on the planet, but your government killed it. Do you remember that, Chris?
Yeah, that's the Avro Arrow. That was
the Avro Arrow. One of the best damn fighter planes on the planet. That was Canadian ingenuity. So I don't mean to cut Canadians out when I talk about American ingenuity. And if you want to get nitpicky about this, if you want to talk about people who are Americans, well, the North American continent includes Mexico, United States, Canada. Okay? So Mexicans, Canadians, you're a fellow Americans.
And then oddly enough, you know, almost all of our windmills come from overseas. They come from Scandinavian countries. Mm-hmm. They're all put on freighters, which, by the way, burn bunker oil and burn all this. They don't come over on sailing ships, folks. And all of those freighters come in down the St. Lawrence through the Great Lakes system. They usually ship them up to Duluth, where they're taken off and then transported by truck. And then they're installed by people who, you know, work for a short period of time installing these things, and they make very few permanent jobs. So when people tell you about all the jobs that are going to be created, I mean, yeah, it's a very narrow demographic. It's usually young males that would have these jobs. Mm-hmm. You know, guys that are kind of construction workers, you hear that, oh, shovel ready job. But
yeah, you don't have solar powered C-130 cargo planes.
Yeah. And even these solar power plants, they're sort of like Amazon warehouses. There's a couple of people that replace hard drives that go bad, but there aren't people working in there. You have things where the lights are sort of off, and you have a solar panel farm. It's just sitting out there. There aren't people milling around doing things. There may be one or two people that work in a small building that monitor what's going on, but these things do not create large amounts of jobs that are, you know, permanent jobs, a lot of temporary jobs in construction, but that's it. So don't buy that story about this is, oh, it's going to, I hear Biden talk, oh, we're going to have all these new jobs, millions of jobs.
Well, the gas and oil that would have come to us from the XL pipeline through Pennsylvania is going to come to us on truck, and that's going to create even more CO2 emissions than the stuff that was coming, was going to come to us through the Exxon, or the, what's it called, the XL pipeline?
The Keystone pipeline or
whatever.
Keystone
pipeline, the Keystone pipeline. So we're giving jobs to Canadian
truck drivers.
Truckers.
Yeah.
Rather than people here in the Keystone State.
Yeah, and that goes on and on and on. So, yeah, it's pretty interesting. But I just found the movie surprising that it seems like they were angry that big business was involved in this green energy, as if it should be literally some sort of cottage industry, like, you know, knitting something. It's just bizarre. I mean, it's, if you're going to do it and you're going to replace and you're going to meet the needs of America's energy, you damn well better expect it to be a big business.
Yeah.
I don't know how it's going to work if it does, if it isn't.
330 million people. And more than half of us need to be kept warm in the wintertime. As you can see right behind me, my good old-fashioned biomass-burning stove. Hey, I got a biomass-burning stove.
Yeah, you're burning biomass. I know. Listen, we are both carbon-free philosophers. We're carbon-free. Trademark that. That's trademarked. That's registered, because that's the truth. And by the way, that's been fact-checked.
Exactly. Exactly.
And you can look it up yourself, but it's fact check.
One more thing I want to digress on. Then I guess that my portion of this is done anyway. And that is population problems. Now, if you watch that movie carefully, the Michael Moore movie, not his critics' response, you will find Jeff Gibbs saying near the end of the movie, what's the real problem here? The problem is us. There's too many of us. Now, what does that conjure up right away? That conjures up population control. Yet, when they reply to their critics, and their critics hit them on this issue, they deny that they're in favor of fascist, and they say this.
Yeah, they use
Jeff
that term.
Gibbs says this in the response. We deny that we are in favor of fascist population control. Now, of course, what popped into my head was, okay, if it's not fascist population control, is there some other kind of population control that you're interested in?
I'll tell you, here's their answer. Their answer is the sort of utopian vision that once we equalized wealth throughout the world and women don't need to have children to provide labor sources, that the birth rates will naturally go down. And, you know, we'll all end up living in some sort of a worldwide utopia. There's not a lot of evidence that that's, it does work as countries become more developed, birth rates do go down. And so much so that I think Michael Crichton talks about this, that estimates of world population are now, by the UN and others, showing we're getting close to a top, and we may well have some kind of decline fairly soon. So it's not, no one really quite knows. And nor do we know, you heard this discussion about carrying capacity, and you probably remember this when we were younger in our 20s and 30s, people said, oh, the Earth can't support more than 4 billion people, because I think at the time we were like 3.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, 4 billion, it'll be over, there'll be mass starvation. And now, I mean, we're damn near double that.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not going to double the population. In most people's lifetimes today, we will not double the population.
In the mid-70s, I can remember hearing a report on National Public Radio, on PBS, a government statistician was complaining about the fact that that portion of our population that pays taxes and actually supports things are not having enough children, because the portion of the population that pays taxes has the children that will grow up to pay taxes, whereas the portion of the population that doesn't pay taxes is having far more children, and they're growing. And so the complaint was, you taxpayers have to produce more children, okay, like yourselves. That was scary. That scared the hell out of me to hear that from the government, okay? But, you know, if you face a declining population in one section of the country, one section of the population, the whole one section of our demographics, whatever, okay, and it's that portion that actually gets up, goes to work, pays taxes, you are going to face problems big time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Problems big time, as we will have more people who are being stimulated by the government, mm-hmm, than we are people who are feeding into it. That's already our problem now, with deficit spending.
Well, this was the comment that Mitt Romney took hell for saying, you know, you've got the, what was it, the 49% are working hard to pay for the 51% that aren't doing anything or something. It was some set of numbers that were basically 50-50, and people were so angry about that. And
yeah, he was absolutely right about
it's
that.
An interesting question.
I hate saying that Mitt Romney was right about something.
I know. Well, you know, but let's first of all, I think an interesting thing, as we've talked about this before, is we don't really know what a much smaller population would mean, because it's not at all clear that all of a sudden we become a land of plenty. There's just so much more stuff available for the rest of us. It's not clear, because there isn't going to be people making the stuff. So it's not clear. And this feeds into this whole argument about what we really need to have is a much lower standard of living. And that's another thing to explore, but it's not clear. First of all, it's not clear what the heck that really means, to have a lower standard of living. And it's not clear how that really works, how that really works. I mean, do you really want to go? What is that lower standard of living? Should we
back to medieval sumptuary laws?
And who's going to make the decisions about, and you get right into this debate, which we talked about needs and wants, which we'll talk about more next time. But who begins to make that decision about, well, you don't really need this and that. Those are things that are wants, and so we are going to eliminate them. And I don't know how you do that without that being fascistic. Some government agency says
we peons will have certain things banned to us, but you can be damn sure that the people doing the banning will have those very things.
We'll get there. So you won't be able to have an automobile anymore. But if you belong to the Politburo, you'll have a nice...
An automobile.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And so you'll be living out the standard at lower... They'll be telling you that you're going to live a lower standard of living, and you will be happy with it because you're saving the planet. And aren't you a good citizen?
Yes. Read history, children. Read history. Look at what's happened. Okay, and it is repeating itself. It will repeat itself. Human beings are creatures of habit.
Mm-hmm. And I'm it's not so clear. You know, none of these people, they speak in very vague terms about, well, you know, we've got to address our standards of living.
And yeah, how do you do that?
I don't know what that means. I know what it means. You know, if you do it Soviet style, it means if you have the average, say, 3-bedroom, 1,500 square foot home, all of a sudden there are two other families that are now moving in with you. And then not a damn thing you can do about it. So if you want that, if you're ready to volunteer for that, which you could volunteer now, but if you're ready to have that forced on you, then there you go.
So Michael Moore, tell us, how do we enact your vision?
Yeah. How does it all work? And then give me the utopian vision. And I love this too. It's another thing, and we've talked about this before. You can always tell a utopian because they always use the word solution, the solution to this problem. And as we've pointed out, technically, you solve mathematical problems. You do not solve social problems. You manage them. You might improve things, but you don't solve them in the sense that they completely go away.
Well, from my side here in Johnstown, Pennsylvania, I'm going to say I'm digressed out for the evening.
Digressed out, yeah. We'll talk a little bit maybe next time about this wants versus
wants and needs.
And I will do this thing about the, by the way, I'll send you the article about the history of deodorant, because it mentions that the woman that's, that there's a woman who's writing her doctoral dissertation on the history of deodorant marketing, which I think is a very strange thing to have a dissertation. I'm not quite sure what you do with that after you have it.
Well, interesting piece of history.
It is an interesting piece of history.
Economic history.
Awfully, yeah. I mean, it and you know, I am using it and talking about it. So I guess there's some value. It seems pretty odd though to explain to somebody that your doctorate is in the history of the marketing of deodorant. But it's a very interesting test case to talk about the idea of wants versus needs.
Okay. Send me that article, which, by the way, we talked about in our backstage show, to which no one's admitted but Chris and I, by the way, because we don't have a Patreon account and we're not expecting you to become members. Okay. But please, if you would, hit that like button and subscribe to the Digressionists, and you might actually get a video next week.
Yeah, if we can, I know we can't keep our fans waiting because they keep clamoring for.
Oh, they keep clamoring. I know our Canadian fans, at least two of our Canadian fans have asked me about when is the next video coming.
Well, you know what? I'm very thankful and I'm flattered that they come.
And I am too.
I mean, it's
God
a thing.
Bless Canada.
Yes, Canada.
And by the way, Canadians, just a piece of advice. You want to go to the Winter Star Party this year? Fly to Mexico and come across with the next caravan. The borders in the south are certainly not closed.
Yeah, you can just get right in and away you go. Yeah, I've always thought about that. Wouldn't it be better to just go to Mexico and then come across as an undocumented, illegal, and then all of a sudden everything opens up for you, free health care, free. You get everything and you're like, wait a minute, when I lived in America, I don't get any of this stuff.
I know, Joe Biden will stimulate you in extremis.
We okay. should all go in a giant flood to Mexico and come across the border. All righty, I don't know what we're at time-wise, so I guess we're
about 45
ready.
Minutes.
45
minutes.
That's
yeah,
pretty
a short
good.
One.
That's pretty okay, good.
I'm going to say goodnight from Johnstown, Pennsylvania.
And good night from Columbus. I guess I will figure out here how to do the end of the recording and we'll go from there. So
okay.
Thank you all for watching. Take care.